Most Calculus 1 classes begin with a study of limits, but they don't always go into a great level of detail as to why. We don't always talk about what the reason for studying limits is. It's easy just to get into the course and just start doing these things called limits. But it really kind of helps if you understand the reason behind studying limits. And so if you take a big picture view of like a Calculus 1 course, there's really two main questions that we're trying to answer in this class. The first one is, what's the slope of a given curve? So if you have a curve here and you highlight a particular value, let's say like right here, we're interested in what the slope would be instantaneously at that point, exactly at this point, where in previous math classes, like your algebra classes, you may have found the slope of a line, but that stayed constant. You usually use the letter m, y equals mx plus b. But if you have a curve, notice the slope will change from positive to negative to positive, depending on where you are at on the curve. And number two, the other big question is, what's the area under a curve? So again, if you take a similar looking curve and you give it a starting and an ending value, we'll be interested in the answer to, what's the area under this curve from A to B, if we call this A and we call this B. And it turns out limits help answer both of these questions. And so that's really the main idea. Now, I'm not going to go through a big discussion of what limits are and how to evaluate limits. That'll come in other videos. But let me just briefly explain how these two topics or these two questions tie into the study of limits. So when you're looking at the slope of a curve exactly at this point here, you'll notice that we've never learned how to find the slope at one point. Normally we need 2 points to evaluate slope. So what we do is we throw in an extra point, a supplementary point, to where if this is x, then this point here will be either in x plus h in some textbooks or x plus delta x in other textbooks. But it's the same thing. H or delta x is just representing some small numerical value. For instance, x might be 5, and x plus h might be 5.1, where the h would be like 0.1, for instance. So if we find the slope between these two values, or these 2 points, we'll get something like this. We'll get f of x plus h, the y value here, or the second x value, minus f of x, all divided by x plus h minus x. And if you're wondering where I got that from, that's roughly like y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1 that you learned in your algebra class. Both of these are standing for what we would call slope. It's simply rise over run. It's the vertical change over the horizontal change in distance. Now, if you look closely, you'll notice that the slope of the yellow line is not exactly the slope of the pink line. So the goal now would be to take this approximation and make it better and better. Now, if you think about how you would make this better, I think what you'll wind up deciding on is, if I can move that second dot closer to the first dot, if I can slowly move it down the line, then each subsequent secant line slope would get better and better and more exact to the slope of the tangent line that touches only at one point. So another way to say that is, if you take f of x plus h minus f of x all divided by x plus h minus x, you take this quantity, this would get more accurate if the h term went away. In other words, as the h goes to zero, then x plus h will move closer to x. Now, that seems simple on the surface of it, but notice h technically is not allowed to be zero. But yet, we know that this yellow dot does need to move to the left to make this slope more and more like the slope of the pink line, which is our answer. This is where limits comes in. Study of limits. We can take the limit or see what this ratio approaches, not what it equals exactly when h is 0, but see what happens as the h gets closer to 0. And what we should get is the slope of the tangent line we were looking for. So again, I'm leaving out a lot of detail as far as how to find limits, but I'm just trying to, in this video, give some connections as to why we would want to study limits. The second big question studied in Calc 1 is, how do you find the area under a curve from one point to another? Well, obviously for most functions, there's no nice geometric shape. It's not a box, it's not a triangle, it's not a trapezoid. So usually if it has a smooth top, we're pretty much stuck. So one idea would be to break this up into intervals, and then within each little subinterval, we can create rectangles, one right after the other. Now the reason I chose rectangles was because I actually know the area of a rectangle is simply width times height, and I can actually determine both of those. It's pretty simple algebra to determine the width of each little subinterval, and the height, you notice, simply touches the curve at certain x values. Now, obviously here there's some error involved, because you see there's some either area missing or area this extra that we need to account for. But basically, if we can take a sum of, you know, some areas here, I'll just call these a sub I, that's the area in the ith subinterval, I equals 1 to n, and where n is the number of rectangles, that will get you an approximation to the area. But now here's the question, how could I make this approximation a little bit better? How could I make it more like the exact area under the curve? Well, the answer is simple. I just need more rectangles. The more rectangles I have, the more accurate this approximation will be. Now, ideally, I don't want 10, I don't want 100, I don't want 1,000. I would actually want to take a limit, or see what it approaches as the number of rectangles approaches infinity. Now, can I ever get an infinite number of rectangles? No, not really, but I can at least see where that would converge to. I can see what it would lead to, which will give me the exact area under the curve. So both of these major landmark topics heavily, heavily rely on a knowledge of limits. Now, just to be honest, when we actually get into the algebra, it turns out, lucky for us, that there are shorter ways to find the slope of a curve without using limits. And there are shorter ways to find the area under a curve without using limits. But for a solid understanding of these fundamental topics, an understanding of limits is absolutely necessary. So now that you kind of have some motivation for learning the topics of limits, you can move on and look at the different ways to evaluate limits and what limits actually are in a little bit more formal sense in the later videos.